Hello, Salam Alaikum, and welcome to this event entitled Libyan General Elections 2021, a discussion series with Libyan leaders. This event is offered in both English and Arabic on the event page. Please choose the player that works best for you. The event is also being live streamed and recorded. I am Michael Yaffe. I am the Vice President of the Middle East North Africa Center here at the United States Institute of Peace, USIP. For those of you who have attended prior USIP events, let me welcome you back. And for those of you who are new to USIP, welcome and permit me to say a few words about the Institute. USIP was created by an act of Congress, the US Congress, in 1984 to serve as an independent, nonpartisan institution dedicated to peace building, particularly the prevention, mitigation, and resolution of violent conflict. We conduct research, training, and convening, and work in conflict zones around the world with a presence in 16 countries. USIP has been working in Libya since 2012, where we conduct research for informing policymakers and practitioners about conflict-related issues, and to help build a local peace infrastructure by strengthening the capacity of key stakeholders, including women and youth, and institutions like the Ministry of Justice. USIP recently began a project with funding for the United States State Department to increase election security by working with the Ministry of Interior to strengthen the police's ability to partner and problem solve with local communities. In light of the upcoming elections set to begin later this month, today's event is a timely conversation with Mr. Abdul Majeed Saif Al-Nasr. This event is the fourth in a series of moderated discussions USIP is hosting to provide a neutral platform for Libyans seeking to play a critical role, including potentially higher office in a future permanent government. Recordings of the previous interviews with Fatih Bashagha, Fidel Lamin, and Arif Ali Naid, are available at the USIP website. The elections scheduled for the end of December are not just any elections. They will provide Libyans with an opportunity to have their say in representative government, including the first elected president in Libya. Making sure that the elections are fair and safe will be very important. For those of you who are interested in learning more about preventing election violence, we would like to invite you to take one of USIP's online courses on the subject. It's available through the online global campus at www.usipglobalcampus.org. The Preventing Election Violence full-length and micro courses are available in English and are free. An Arabic version will be coming online very soon. And anyone who is interested in having that course in Arabic now should reach out to us at academy@usip.org. Elections are just the beginning of the journey to set Libya on a path to deal with complex issues of governance and sovereignty. Issues like the presence of mercenaries in the country, foreign meddling, institutional disunity, minority inclusion, transitional justice, and other matters are to be decided by a representative government. In the spirit of fostering dialogue, each speaker we host in this series is given several minutes to provide opening remarks where they can address some of these issues, after which I will ask them questions in order to explicate their positions and views. I would try to ask the same questions to all the speakers so people can hear and compare their unique responses. After that, I will turn to the audience members for their questions. To the audience watching online, we encourage you to send questions to Mr. Al-Nasr through the chat box, and we will try to get as many questions as possible. Now, I am pleased to introduce Mr. Abdul Majeed Saif Al-Nasr. Mr. Abdul Majeed was born in Sebha in 1957. He is one of Libya's most prominent politicians from the Awad Suleiman tribe, one of the largest tribes in the south. Mr. Abdul Majeed is a former member of the National Transition Council and served as Libya's ambassador to the Kingdom of Morocco between 2014 and 2018. He was recently endorsed by Libya's House of Representatives as Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary to the Kingdom of Morocco and the Maghreb region. And with that, let me turn the floor over to Mr. Abdul Majeed, and we look forward to your opening remarks, sir.
Thank you very much. And I thank USIP and for the organizers and for the project manager for this invitation. I am Abdul Majeed Saif Al-Nasr. This is just to clarify the name. And I would like to thank USIP for their interest in Libya and for their support to provide or to reach a peaceful solution to Libya and to put an end to violent conflicts. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, you know, why don't we begin the first set of questions, which actually I wanted to raise about the elections themselves. What is your assessment on whether the elections will happen on time or not on time? Noting that there are presidential elections at the end of this month, and hopefully soon thereafter will be parliamentary elections.
First
of all, everyone in Libya wants to see elections organized and happening as planned by the House of Representatives and by the Election Commission. But what is obvious is that there are certain shortcomings, certain challenges that are undermining the process and that will maybe lead to conflicts. And I think everyone needs to accept elections. We don't need elections that lead to division or lead to disruption following these the results. So we need elections that lead to stability and peace. And we see that the commission is taking a lot of time to issue the lists, and we would like or we wish that they can speed up the process and issue the electoral lists so that we can move to the electoral campaigning and ensure the, that the elections take place on the right time. We ultimately hope that these elections will be held without blood, without division, and we wish that we ensure a rotation of power, and that's what Libyans wanted and called for back in February 2011. So we wish that the objectives and goals of the February Revolution be achieved, and to hold free and fair elections, and pray to God that he shows us the right path towards the right and free and fair elections.
Well, great, thank you. Well, as I mentioned in my opening remarks and you just referenced now, obviously there's a lot of concern about the potential for violence around the upcoming election cycle. I was just wondering if you could kind of explain or your views on what do you think are the drivers of potential violence, and then what are the measures that can be taken to ensure a peaceful election cycle?
فتحنا الميكروفون وان شاء الله نسمعك جيدا اول هيك تكون انتخابات حره ونزيهه
yes in order to have or to ensure free and fair elections we need to have Libyans who are keen on the interests of Libya and we need to have people who have been militants before the February Revolution. We don't need, and Libya does not need controversial people We want also the House of Representatives to amend the law in order to have things back on track. And what is very important also is that everyone accepts the results of elections. I think getting into elections, while there are skepticism and there are concerns about the acceptance of the election results, would not lead us to a good process and to fair and free elections ultimately.
But continuing, you know, again, you know, what do you see as the drivers that could potentially cause this to be a violent election? And again, what things could be done to make sure that those things are being handled in the right way?
عاود السؤال.
Well, let me move to a different question, if you will. So obviously,
sorry. The elections.
ولكن الرجوع للماضي.
I think we should not look at the.
يجب أن تودي بنا للأمام لا للخلف.
Past elections should open our path for the future. We should not look to the past. Libyans will not accept to go back to the past. We have given hundreds of martyrs to create a new system of governance. But the problem is that we have people now who are trying to revive the old regime and the old political system. Those who run for these elections should be convinced of the February Revolution, and our youth have sacrificed themselves for this moment and should not betray them, and we should not change our skin in favor of controversial people who are trying to revive the past and revive the old regime. And we are seeing them now in Libya trying to revive the old flag and the old governance system. But this will not take place, and people have sacrificed their lives to reach this moment, and we cannot allow for Libyans or Libya to go back to the past. There is a voice cut from the source. We can't hear the speaker.
Well, okay, we're having a little technical issue here, so let's see if we can. Ah, there he is. Mr. Abdul Majeed, can you hear me now? Mr. Abdul Majeed, can you hear me?
بالله لو سمحت عاود الترجمة ولم استكمل كلامي يعني لحتى الآن حقيقة.
Sorry, sir, can you hear me now? Mr. Abdul Jamil, can you, Majeed, can you hear me? Mr. Abdul Majeed, can you hear me now?
Yes,
now. But I did not complete the answer for the first question.
I'm sorry, could.
He's saying that he did not finish responding to the first question.
Yes, so he can please continue. It looks like our technical problem has been solved.
لم أسمع لإجابة السؤال. زي ما قلت لك لكي نجعل انتخابات صحيحة
لازم As I said, in order to ensure free and fair elections
لكي يكون زي ما سألني الانتخابات كيف تكون صحيحة وناجحة يجب أن نضع لها
We have to ensure sound basis, sound grounds for elections. We should not look to the past, try to revive the old regime. Should work on implementing what has been the aspiration of Libyans and Libyan martyrs to reach this moment. And I think the end of the interim phase and the inauguration of a new system of democratic governance in Libya is a success for the revolution.
Thank you. I apologize for the technical problems we're having. I hope we can keep moving on. So, sir, let me be quite bold here and just ask you, are you running for presidency? Are you running to be Libya's first elected president?
Yes. Yes.
So let me carry that theme forward. So if you become Libya's first elected president, what is your general vision for Libya? How do you foresee your role as a leader in the country? Do you have a general philosophy with regard to leadership in general?
First of all, if God allows me to become the president of a free and united Libya, I will work on social and national reconciliation. How can that be achieved? Through amnesty, through a reparation, and through a restoration of stability in Libya. Libya is a tribal community, but a very strong and united community. So we have to go back and revive that unity, that harmony between tribes, and also gather or take arms from arms that are scattered all over the country now, and get them under the control of the state. Also, get rid of the mercenaries and armed groups that infiltrated Libya. So these troops and these forces should be deported and should be repatriated to their countries, and the control and the security of the country should be under the control of the state and nothing but the state. Also, to take care of those who led the revolution, the revolutionaries who, thanks to whom the revolution succeeded. And these revolutionaries were responsible for the inception of the revolution. It was not the NATO, as they are as people are claiming, but they were true Libyans, and the cities that were under the tyranny of Gaddafi were suffering, and that's why other countries intervened to continue with the revolutionary path. However, these countries that also interfered in Libya should also leave Libya to take its security under its control. And also, as I said, collection of weapons and arms with the establishment of a strong police and strong military in Libya that are loyal to Libya and not to people or to individuals. And these revolutionaries are ready now to enroll in state institutions and the police and the military. And some countries and some individuals are trying to put an end to this revolutionary path, but they will not succeed ultimately.
Thank you. Thank you. You actually anticipated some of my questions with regard to what you would do with regard to the mercenaries and to the foreign fighters. But let me return back to this issue of reconciliation that you first started with, and ask you particularly about questions related to transitional justice. There's a real lack of clarity in the direction of transitional justice in Libya right now. Some people say that there should be a general amnesty so that Libyans can move forward without.
Let me clarify. Maybe I'll try to anticipate the question. We cannot be the president of Libya that is divided or that is supported by foreign forces or foreign countries and foreign mercenaries. Libyans should be in charge and should be responsible for the peace and stability of the country. This is why I anticipated the question. This is primordial. This is very essential. If you may continue with your question.
Okay. No, thank you. Thank you for that clarification. I was talking about transitional justice and the notion of that some people are in favor of a general amnesty for Libyans so they can move forward without relitigating the past, while others advocate for a truth and justice-centered kind of approach where perpetrators of human rights abuses are held accountable and victims feel that justice has been served. What is the path for transitional justice in Libya that, in your view?
I think reconciliation and transitional justice are closely related to each other, along with reparation. When we say reconciliation, we need to focus on amnesty, reparation, and to give favor to victims, because by doing so, we will have a unified Libya. So our reparation and the giving back of grievances to people, this can lead to total reconciliation. Of course, this should be monitored by the next Libyan government. Should monitor this entire reconciliation and the justice process. And if we just focus on the past grievances, we will not move forward, as you said, sir. That's why we need to forgive. We need to be indulgent, to be tolerant, and just we forgive each other. not forgive colonizer or people who vandalized or destroyed Libya. Libyans between each other can forgive each other. We have been many political conflicts and social conflicts, and in order for a new Libya, unified Libya, we need to put the past aside and move forward. Thank you.
Thank you. In your responses so far, you talk a lot about unity, unity of the Libyan people. I'm wondering, what are the things that you would put into place as the first elected president, that in terms of building a culture of unity, the symbols of unity, to increase a national order and national unity amongst the various parts of Libya?
First of all the countries that entered Libya legally with legitimacy and without legitimacy should leave Libya. Secondly, all mercenaries who are assigned in Libya in this proxy war should also leave Libya. We need to sit together, only Libyans, because we are siblings, we are members of the same family. However, there are many external forces trying for Libya destabilization, and they agree upon this instability outside of Libya. They have good commercial relationships, but once they enter Libya, they start conflicting each other. But once they leave it, they have a commerce between each other, they speak to each other, they sign agreements. That's why we need to, for all of these forces to leave Libya and to let Libyans take care of their own businesses by themselves. I think anyone who enters Libya will be, of course, excluded from any future agreement, from any future dialogue. These external forces used Libyans. They paid money and they used Libyans just to destroy Libya. Mainly the revolutionaries of February. Many people distorted the good image of the Arab Spring, distorted the image of February. That's why they need to leave Libya. We don't want to have the Egyptian, maybe, or the Tunisian example. We didn't have police or military or an army to protect Libya as the other neighboring countries. We were alone, just in the forefront with these external forces. But God willing, and with the help of the new independent and the free president of Libya, will unify again Libyans. God willing.
Great, thank you. And to follow that up, I'm wondering what your view is on with regard to previous agreements that were signed by the GNU, the GNA, with foreign governments, including things like the Maritime Boundary Treaty. Would you continue to honor those, or would you seek to renegotiate, or how would you handle those previous agreements?
Of course, all agreements all over the world are maintained by the president or by the prime minister, but should gain the approval of the House of Representatives of the parliament. However, Libya, we had two parliaments, two governments, two prime ministers, and they disagree. So every government or every parliament in the past asked the help of one external force. So all these external forces that entered Libya, we need to ask them, why did you come to Libya? To give us medicine, to give us drugs, to give us food to help Libya, or to just to sell weapons or to to nurture sedition in Libya. That's why all the agreements that were signed for the destruction of Libya should not be continued. But when it comes to the support or assistance from some countries who really intended to help Libya, of course, we need to respect these agreements, and we can ask for a reconciliation. So instead of bringing investments to Libya, they brought ammunition and weapons. There is no victorious party over the other parties. There is one unified and independent Libya.
Okay, thank you. I wanted to return to the theme of unity. We got a question from our audience already, and I'm going to incorporate that into my own question with regard to how will you basically help to unify the government, and particularly taking control of the national army, militia, and gangs? What would be your approach to bringing unity amongst those types of elements of the government and non-government entities?
So let me correct the questions. We don't have militias in Libya or gangs. We have revolutionaries, and without them, we would have returned to the first stage. We have revolutionaries and mercenaries. We have revolutionaries who protected Libya in the difficult moments that Libya witnessed in Tripoli, in Sebha, in the Benghazi, and without their help, we would have had the restoration of the former regime of Gaddafi regime. So our army and these revolutionaries curbed the spread of mercenaries. However, when it comes to mercenaries, once we have a unified army in the south, in the north, and in the east, they will leave and will be expelled from Libya in just 1 month. And I say 1 month. And all the countries that came to Libya as friends, but friends to bring weapons and ammo will be expelled as well. However, the other countries who brought investments will be maintained, supported by Libya. And the countries that supported or helped the destruction of Libya, in the future, we will deal with them as equal countries. If we have commercials, we will not favor them. We will consider them as just commercial or trade rivals, as equal to equal countries. Europe is full of different countries, and the Africans who fled Africa or Libya to Europe, we need to provide them with stability in Libya and in other African countries so that we can bring them back from Europe and we restore and they can restore their former lives. Thank you.
Thank you. And in sticking with this issue of how to bring unity to Libya, I'm wondering how you would approach this idea of inclusiveness of minorities, particularly some of the tribes that are reflect as minorities, not just and also marginalized communities that have been traditionally marginalized in parts of the country. How would you bring all these people together? What is it that you will do as president to unite them?
First of all, this is the policy of the former of the former respective governments. They didn't take care of the different marginalized groups or the different groups or tribes in the past. Now we should no longer talk about minorities or marginalized communities. They should be highly respected by the government. We have a Tuareg and a Tebu. They participated to a February revolution. During the former regime, Gaddafi regime, they were completely marginalized. And the non-Libyan, the non-Libyans, like Libyan tribes, like Amazigh, like Tebu, like Tuareg, this is their land, and they are equal to other Libyans and should be highly respected. And maybe, as the president, I will give more respect, dedicate more respect to minorities than the majority. I think by doing so, we will have a stable Libya, Libya Tripoli, Libya Fazan, Libya Tobruk. All of these areas should coexist with each other, and it is amongst the main triggers, the main drivers towards the unification of Libya. As I said, again, Libya should be unified, but of course, Libya without mercenaries, without the countries that intend to vandalize Libya, to bring destruction to Libya. We are working under the surveillance and the assistance of the United Nations and the other super power countries. And we are not living in an isolated island. We live in a world, and we should always work together. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. As you talked about bringing together all the various parts of Libya, I wonder, though, as has generally been a common theme, where power gets very centralized in Tripoli. And I wonder how you view the issue of centralization of power versus decentralization, how to distribute power throughout the country, and how would you do that in terms of making sure that to minimize the marginalization of areas that have previously been feeling marginalized, particularly like in the south.
So our main symbol or a credo is no centralization, no fragmented Libya, just one Libya. So it is easy to defeat a centralization through municipalities, municipal councils, where you give them power, or we work on the devolution of power from the center to the local. Also, the ministries should have representatives in all Libyan areas, offices of every ministry in every Libyan area, in order to take care of all the problems and the specificity of every area. Moreover, these municipal councils should have their own independent budgets, and their budgets should not come solely from Benghazi or Sebha or Tripoli, and should have their own independent budget. They can make decisions on their own. So we need to have a technique of a globalization in Libya. So the citizen who are living in remote areas can have his salary dispersed every month appropriately and normally, and should have all the public facilities and all the services delivered in this remote area. Also, when it comes to universities, the big universities, the most important ones, like med schools, should be in all or in the main areas of Libya. By doing so, we can have a unified Libya. Also, when it comes to schools,
we need to have schools in all in all areas. Also, I have an idea. Is that, for example, in one area, you create or establish a big mid school or a big primary or school where all Libyans can come there and study and meet with each other under the control of the representative of the government, and by doing so, all Libyans can come together, can communicate.
Great, thank you. You mentioned a little bit before about relations, particularly with countries south of Libya, and that raises a question about migration. There have been, of course, a number of arrests of migrants in the Tripoli area, and human rights organizations have accused authorities of human rights violations. Of the new government with regard to migration, and including how that is handled in areas where there has been political and economic marginalization, such as in the Fezzan region.
Migration has been a big problem in Libya, and Libya was not able to manage migration flows that brought many problems, was very negative to our youth also. Countries did not help Libya manage migration. This migration also had bad repercussions on Europe and neighboring countries. So regarding migration, border guards should be empowered to work in the border areas, should not be located or centralized in Tripoli or big cities. And those who are now helping the migration issues are the revolutionaries. They are managing migration. If you go to the south, for example, you will see that revolutionaries from Tabu, from Tuareg, and some Arabs are managing migration, and the state is not helping them. So our plan here is to have strong border guards presence in the border regions with a strong budget to manage and to counter irregular migration. Irregular migration has put Libya in a very bad place, and migration is bringing people to fight Libyans. So we have to get rid of those who are thriving on irregular migration. And also, as I said, the bigger picture, working on the bigger picture, like developing the sub-Saharan countries and African countries, so that people would like to stay in these countries. And in Libya, once united, we will counter and manage migration by Libyans themselves, by Libyan citizens, and not the military or the police. And it's very rare to see military or Libyan military or Libyan army managing migration or dealing with migration. It's the revolutionaries that are very courageously dealing with the irregular migration. The head of the border guards in the south are understaffed, are under-equipped, but they are doing a great job thanks to the revolutionaries. So I think what I need to say here is that we have to consider managing migration as a priority in Libya, because it will help us restructure and rebuild the nation. Thank you. Mike, please, it's mute.
We have a, thank you for your answer. We have a question from the audience with regard to foreign affairs. I'll read it to you. It says, Libya needs international support for stability and development. From your point of view, which are the countries you would like to collaborate with and why?
I am a Libyan free man, and I am interested in Libya and the interests of Libya. So we are ready to cooperate with all countries, with all countries in favor of building Libya back. So everyone who wants to help for the stability of Libya is welcomed, and we are going to collaborate with them, like the United States, for example, which did not intervene in Libya in a bad way or with weapons. It interfered, or it intervened in Libya for the best interest of Libya, and many Arab countries also did the same. Even those who took sides, either the East or the West, have now the opportunity to get back to the right track, because Libya does not need weapons, does not need conflicts, but needs development, stability, and so on and so forth. It's a pity that thousands of Libyans have died from 2011. Some who are not interested in the stability of Libya will be countered and will be defeated, because here we are only interested in Libya, and we will be brothers to our brothers and friends, to our true friends, without discrimination. And when we are elected by Libyans, we will represent Libyans, and we will handle other countries and other states as friends and as brothers and sisters. If these countries will choose side on against another side, of course, Libyans will counter them. Thank you.
Well, to follow up, you mentioned particularly the United States in that case, but I'm curious to see if there are other countries that you would also be looking to specifically for assistance and development help.
I have two categories of countries. There are countries which did not intervene in a negative way in the conflict in Libya, but the countries that supported the conflict and provided weapons and mercenaries will have a different treatment, and we will talk to them. We will ask them, instead of weapons, instead of fueling the conflict, we want them to invest in commerce and business and in development. That's the way we will deal with countries. So for the countries that did not intervene actively in the conflict and helped Libyans in the crisis, that's easy to deal with them. And for those which provided weapons, we will tell them, enough with that, enough with the conflict and with the weapons, and but we will welcome them if they want to invest in education, in development, in the training of the military or the police, or the rehabilitation of the revolutionaries. And thus, everyone will benefit. Libya is a rich country, and we are ready to collaborate with everyone. That's our policy, God willing, and we hope that if other presidents are elected, they will have the same policy, and they will be interested in the stability on Libya. Libya is not ready for more destruction, and if a country is trying to choose that camp or that orientation, they will ultimately fail.
Thank you. I wanted to return to the question that you talked about with regard to revolutionaries, as you called them, and the role that they have played in Libya's past. I wonder, though, how you would view how the relationship with those revolutionaries going forward, in terms of, would you incorporate them into the police? Would you incorporate them into the army? How will you handle that type of development going forward?
مرحبا. لا لا ما اسمع السؤال انقطع البت.
Are we having more technical problems here?
We repeat the question and he will be answering now.
Okay, great, thank you.
Revolutionaries, as I said, have played an important role to lead the revolution of February, and they played a significant role in the in this process, and they will be treated very well. For those who want to enroll or to integrate the police and the army, we will help with that. And if, of course, it depends on their credentials and their qualifications. You know, there are doctors and there are engineers, and they are part of the revolutionaries, and they have sacrificed a lot. So these doctors and engineers, if they want to have scholarships to study abroad, we will help with that also. Some merchants or traders also, or business people, we will help them to build their businesses or to further develop their work. And those who want to rest, maybe they don't want to work in the police or the military, they will have a pension or like what's provided for the ex-veterans or for the les anciens combattants. So that's what we will do. But ultimately, we need to collect the weapons and to ensure the stability of Libya, that no conflicts or no violence will erupt. And that's key, actually, to ensure also even the peaceful rotation and transfer of power. You know also that some of them have lost their limbs, some lost their arms or legs, and their families are displaced. So we will focus on these people, and we will establish an authority department that will take care of these people and also the families of the martyrs. And even those who died while on the side of the former regime, we will take care of them. And they are all Libyans, ultimately. There is another important point that I wanted you to ask me, to ask about, which is the return of migrants, Libyan migrants abroad. And we have a plan for that. We have a plan to ensure the return of Libyans who are imprisoned abroad, or Libyans who have fled their country. And we will promise that they can return to Libya safely, and if they are serving sentences, they can continue their sentences in Libya. Otherwise, they will be welcomed back to Libya. And for those who have committed crimes, that we can ensure, and we will ensure that they will have a fair trial. But ultimately, what I want to say, and my message here, is that Libya is a land of forgiveness, and it will welcome all its children, wherever they are. The February Revolution is a revolution of mercy, and the heroes of the revolution will accept and forgive others. So we will not... So we will continue with the same path in order to ensure a safe and free and independent Libya.
Great, thank you. And thank you for approaching the subject of expat Libyans and their return. We only have a few minutes left, but I wanted to go back to a question I had asked you in the beginning. And let me rephrase it just a slightly different, which is about if you become the first president, I wondered if you could give us some insight into the way you think about leadership in general, perhaps people that you admire, leaders in other circumstances. What are the things that influence you as a leader and build your philosophy as a leader?
So
the existing leaders or the former leaders or past leaders?
I'm just talking about people that have influenced you and influenced your thinking about leadership in general. Who do you admire?
أولا الملك إدريس الله يرحمه كان رجلا يعمل
So King Idris, he was a great man. He worked under Bashir al-Sadawi, who sacrificed his life for the independence of Libya, and so Hamad bin Nasser, Omar al-Mukhtar, and Said Lati, which and also Gaddafi. We should not forget Gaddafi. Not all that he did was wrong. Many of what he did, Gaddafi was good. But the problem with Gaddafi is with his consultants. Many of them were corrupt people. Also, we should never forget Mustafa Abdel Jalil, who assumed the responsibility on February 17th, where no Libyan could fight for Libya at that moment. And Mustafa Abdel Jalil assumed the responsibility and worked on a peaceful rotation of power. You know that February ended up in forming the National Congress, where the revolutionaries and all Libyans from during the monarchy until February gave the power to the National Congress. Also, we should never forget former prime ministers who assumed the responsibility from February until present. Sorry, the sound is cut.
Mr. Abdul Majeed, Majeed, could you hear me? Can you hear me?
I'm asking him if he can continue. So do you want me to give you examples of Arab leaders or international leaders or just Libyan ones?
Well, I was just asking about the people you most admire and how they influence your thinking.
هل ليبيين أو حتى غير ليبيين؟ زي ما قلت الليبيين كتار الحقيقة.
As I said, many Libyans, Mr. Aguila, also who was the Speaker of the House of Representatives, Mr. Khalifa Haftar, of course they have defects and they have qualities. Also the different members of the State Council, all Libyans who assumed responsibility and hopefully they do not have any foreign agenda and they have loyalty just to God and Libya. Also those who worked in the GNU and GNA in the Arab world, Sheikh Zayed maybe, and we need to salute him. Also the king of Saudi Arabia. Also we should never forget the role of Qatar, who helped Libya tremendously. We should not also forget the role played by the United States, by Italy, Germany, and many other European countries. And I think the problem is not with mostly with these external countries, but with Libyans themselves, whether Qatar or Saudi Arabia or Egypt or whatever. I can think Libyans themselves who had malicious intentions, malicious plans, not these countries, but any Libyan who served his country, who supported Libya should be saluted, whether a Libyan leader or international leader. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you for providing the answers to so many questions today. I wonder if you had we only have a minute left. I was wondering if you had any last thoughts you wanted to convey right now.
First of all, I would like to thank you for this opportunity. And I'm asking God to support us, and no one can deny the support and the role of the United States. I hope you provide peace not only to Libya, but all the countries. Also, we should not forget to mention the role or responsibility assumed by revolutionaries. Libya is a generation of uprisings, and all of these uprisings were led by Libyans, revolutionaries. And since 2011 till today, many people have given a lot to Libya. Unfortunately, but I think it is a good thing. Libya is a country of the new thing, and the new generations, and new spirits. And we hope to have in the near future spirits or new spirits, a new generation of stability, of peace, of justice. Hopefully, we reach to a unified Libya under independent authority and power. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for spending the time with us today. I would like to thank a few people before we close out here for helping to organize today's event, particularly USIP's country director, Nate Wilson, Ezra El-Bakush, as well as Ali Ansari, who helped to actually organize the actual timing for this event, and as well to the interpreters and to the AV staff for pulling this event together. As I mentioned, this is the fourth of our in our series of interviews with Libyan leaders. We look forward to holding future events in the near future with regard to further interviews with leaders from Libya. So thank you everybody for joining us, and wish you all a very good day.